knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
We've spent the past few tutorials looking at first-order differential equations, but now it's time to move on to second-order differential equations. As the name suggests, these are DEs that contain a second derivative term, like d squared y dx squared. What could such a thing be used for? As it turns out, this kind of differential equation crops up everywhere in physics. That's because Newton's second law, while commonly written as F equals ma, is actually a second-order differential equation in disguise, since acceleration can be defined as the rate of change in velocity, which in turn is the rate of change in displacement. We'll see more examples of this kind of thing later, but first, let's get to grips with the basics. Firstly, let's define what is meant by a linear, homogeneous, second-order differential equation. This will be any dE of the general form d squared y dx squared plus p of x times dy dx plus q of x times y equals zero. But we're actually going to restrict this form a little more, and we're going to look at the constant coefficients case, where all the coefficients that could be functions of x are actually just constants. We are therefore really learning about solving differential equations of the form a times d squared y dx squared plus b times dy dx plus c times y equals zero. To solve this, we are going to write down something called a characteristic equation, or sometimes known as an auxiliary equation. We convert the derivatives into powers of an unknown variable, lambda, giving us a times lambda squared plus b times lambda plus c, which is a quadratic equation in lambda. We can solve this using the quadratic equation to get two solutions, which we'll call lambda 1 and lambda 2. It turns out that if we take y equals e to the lambda x as a guess solution, or ansatz solution, then this will always satisfy our differential equation in the cases where lambda is either lambda 1 or lambda 2 from our characteristic equation. We now need to learn an important fact. For any linear differential equation, no matter what order, if we can find any number of different linearly independent solutions, we can say for sure that their sum, when multiplied by any set of constant coefficients, will also be a solution, which is a fact known as the superposition principle. Let's apply this to our second-order DE, where we know that e to the lambda 1 x and e to the lambda 2 x are both solutions. There are three possible cases. First, if lambda 1 and lambda 2 are distinct real numbers, then we already have two linearly independent solutions, so we can directly apply the superposition principle to get the general solution to our DE as y equals a times e to the lambda 1 x plus b times e to the lambda 2 x, where a and b are independent arbitrary constants. The second case is if our roots lambda 1 and lambda 2 are not real, but instead complex numbers. In this case, since the coefficients of our DE are real, the complex roots lambda 1 and lambda 2 must be complex conjugates of each other, so we can write them as lambda 1 equals alpha plus beta I, and lambda 2 equals alpha minus beta I, where alpha and beta are the real and imaginary parts of lambda, respectively. Using some complex number arithmetic, which we'll skip, we can show that the appropriate ansatz solutions are y1 equals e to the alpha x times cosine of beta x, and y2 equals e to the alpha x times sine of beta x. So by superposition, our general solution for the case of complex roots is y equals e to the alpha x times the quantity a times cosine of beta x plus b times sine of beta x. The third and final case is if the characteristic equation has a single repeated real root. In this case, we will only actually have one ansatz, which is just e to the lambda x, so we can't use the principle of superposition. The good news is that it's an easy fix. Whenever we have a repeated root, we can just multiply our ansatz by x to get a linearly independent function that is still a solution to our DE. So for this repeated roots case, the general solution will be a times e to the lambda x plus b times x times e to the lambda x, and we can factor out the exponential to get this neat form shown here, e to the lambda x times the quantity a plus bx. These three cases, real distinct roots, complex roots, and repeated root, are worth committing to memory because when solving second-order DEs, the algebra can get pretty lengthy, so it will really help if we can just cut straight to these solutions as and when we need them. Now let's look at how to use boundary conditions with this type of DE. Since we have two unknown constants, A and B, in our general solution, we will require two different boundary conditions to completely identify a particular solution. Sometimes these will be given to us as the values of the function y, as well as its derivative dy dx, or y prime, at some point x. This is called an initial value problem, or IVP. Other times, we might be given two different values of y at two different values of x, which is a boundary value problem, or BVP. Either way, we need to substitute these conditions into our general solution, and if it's an IVP, we'll need to first differentiate our general solution before subbing in the given point x. We will then end up with a system of two algebraic equations in two unknowns, which can easily be solved by elimination to yield our particular solution. Let's wrap up this section with an application that you will become very familiar with if you go on to use differential equations in a physics or engineering context. Suppose that we have a trolley of mass m kilograms sliding on frictionless horizontal rails. Attached to the trolley is a spring with a stiffness k newtons per meter, as well as a dashpot with a damping rate of c newton seconds per meter. We know that springs exert elastic forces, given by F equals negative kx, according to Hooke's law, where x is the extension or displacement. But what is a dashpot? A dashpot, also called a damper, is essentially a piston in a viscous fluid, and it produces a force proportional to and opposing the relative velocity v between its ends, so that F equals negative c times v. This means a dashpot will exert a large resistive force on the trolley when the trolley moves quickly, damping its motion. Since speed is the rate of change of displacement x, we can say that the dashpot force, in our case, is given by negative c times dx dt. Newton's second law states that the sum of the forces acting on the trolley must equal m times a. We know that acceleration a is the rate of change of velocity, which in turn is the rate of change of displacement. So we can write a as the second derivative of x, and we can put in our spring and dashpot forces as shown. If we move everything to one side, we end up with the equation m times the second derivative of x plus c times the first derivative of x plus k times x equals zero, which exactly matches a linear homogeneous second-order differential equation with constant coefficients. We can therefore jump right to our solutions that we found earlier to completely describe the motion of the trolley for all times t. And in fact, the three cases that we learned have some notable physical significance. In the first case, the roots of the characteristic equation were real, and we say that the motion is overdamped, and the trolley will be slowly brought to rest. In the second case, the roots were complex, and due to the trigonometric functions in the solution, we will see oscillations back and forth, eventually converging on a stable equilibrium position, a type of motion we call underdamped. In the third case of a repeated root, we say that the motion is critically damped, which gives us no oscillations and brings the trolley to rest in the shortest possible time. Notice that if c equals zero, we will just have a mass on a spring, with no damping effect at all, and the oscillations will go on forever, which is called simple harmonic motion. Let's check comprehension.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.